This is a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, made possible by the Friends of SDPB. Pledge your support for quality programming. Call Friends at 800-333-0789 or donate online at sdpb.org. You may purchase this video and many others online at our website. Click on Shop SDPB. And thank you.
This high school activities championship event is conducted under the auspices of the South Dakota High School Activities Association.
Hey, good afternoon, South Dakota, and folks tuning in around the country and around the globe at sdpb.org. From the Dakota Dome in Vermilion, it is the Class 11B Championship Football Game with Craig Maddock from Sioux Falls Sports Radio, 1230 KWSN. I'm Mike Henriksen from Sports Max and from Calling All Sports. Great to have you joining us, Craig. Year in and year out, the 11B game has given us some terrific contests through the years, and I expect this one to be exactly that.
Totally agree with you. Canton comes in here, their third trip to the title game. They have won two championships. They are 10-1 on the season. They're taking on Parkston, also their third trip to the Dome. But for Canton, they have won 9 in a row. They have set a school record in offense. This is a team that is absolutely on a roll. They have gone on the road and defeated Aberdeen-Roncalli, and the winner just to get here. Nobody else has had a tougher postseason schedule.
Their only loss has been to Parkston, the second game of the year, 21-14. Both teams, though, have improved since that time. And take a look, Canton with the shutout of West Central back on October the 4th.
They got a lot of people with the eyebrows. Of course, West Central won the 11A title last night.
And of course, Tri-Valley went down and almost knocked off Winter, down in Winter. So some very good teams that they beat down the stretch. They have been on a roll. And then, as you mentioned, on the road, they shut out McCook Central Montrose. They go to Aberdeen-Roncalli and beat the previously undefeated Cavaliers. And then they travel out to Winter and beat the previously undefeated Winter Warriors. And according to our friend Dan Gensler at sdsportshistory.com, 800 miles worth of road trip for their playoffs.
This is just a hop, skip, and a jump to Vermilion.
Very much so. Game. Yeah, Canton, of course, right there on the Iowa border, as Rich Lundstrom is their head coach. And earlier this week, we had a chance to sit down and chat with the head coach of the Canton Seahawks, Rich Lundstrom.
We started out with a win against Bonholm, and then Parkston beat us in the second week of the season. And we rattled off, you know, what, 8 straight wins. In the playoffs, we had to travel to Roncalli and to Winter, who were obviously probably widely considered the top two teams in the state by the sports writers and all of them. And our kids played great and came out with wins in those two games. We run the ball pretty well. Our line has been blocking pretty darn good lately. Our backs really block hard for each other and run hard when they do have the ball. Defensively, we've been pretty solid. This is the third year in Matt David's system. He's my defensive coordinator, and the kids have really bought into the system, and they since they've been in it for 3 years, they're just reacting now. They're not trying to think about what they're supposed to be doing. And, you know, they're fun to watch on defense. They fly around. He's got all kinds of blitzes, and it's a good time. Community support has been great. You know, they always support us. You know, Canton's kind of a football town, and the team always, or the town always gets behind the team, no matter how we're doing. But when it's a season like this, it's even amplified more. So it's been great. You know, we have to be more disciplined defensively so that they don't hit those big plays. And then offensively, we have to block a little better than we did the first time around. But it's going to be a great game. They're a good team. I think we're a good team. I think we're evenly matched. You know, the first game was a touchdown. They beat us by a touchdown. I think this is going to be a close, hard-fought game also.
As you get a look at the Canton Seahawks warming up here prior to the kickoff of the game, let's take a look at those starting lineups. Canton Seahawks, some good size up front, Craig. Estabrook, Van Vorst, Lems, Eshe, and Lastly. They all well over 200 pounds, but three juniors in that offensive line.
Estabrook and Lems both in double digits when it comes to pancake blocks, too. They love to make contact.
Meanwhile, Cody Majors, yes, that's how you pronounce it. Cody Majors is a force to be reckoned with on offense.
He's real quick, too.
He can fly. Gabe Dolan, Jake Ablett, Tanner Broughton, Bryce Schrodermeyer will be a wideout, as will Eli Ripley, as you get a look at the offensive starters. And we'll talk more about that offense in just a moment.
You know, defensively, if there's one chink in the armor, Jaden Broughton was a starter, tore his ACL last week with Winter. He'll be replaced by Alex DeYoung. He is just a freshman on that linebacking core. Otherwise, with Lems and Van Vorst, Schurz and Dolan, Tanner Broughton, that's the brother of Jaden Broughton, who tore his ACL. Then Alex DeYoung, the freshman, and Schrodermeyer up front. And then Majors, Peterson, Ripley, and Ablett back deep. Majors with a 103-yard interception return during the season as well.
And there you get a good look at Cody Majors. You were talking about his speed, Craig. He is a playing quarterback, and he can fly.
He was third in the 100 in the last track season. He, rushing-wise, only about 600 yards rushing on the year, but he's able to distribute real well, make that 700 yards rushing, 500 yards passing. This is a explosive team offensively, the Canton Seahawks.
Very much so. And again, though, their defense has been playing very, very solid as well, as you witnessed by the shutouts to wrap up the regular season. And then they have not given up much during the playoffs at all. When we come back to the Dakota Dome in Vermilion, we'll take a look at the Parkston Trojans. Parkston in the Dome, looking to wrap up their season with a championship. We're back to the Dakota Dome in Vermilion after this time out on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. With Craig Maddock from Sioux Falls Sports Radio, KWSN, and Steve Toome also joining the broadcast this afternoon from South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm Mike Henriksen. Class 11B football, Canton taking on the Parkston Trojans. Let's take a look at Parkston. Parkston, of course, straight south of Mitchell. And they have had great tradition when it comes to athletics. Boys, girls, football, basketball, baseball, track, you name it.
It's been 11 years, though, since they've been in the Dome, Mike. They were last here in 2002. This is their third trip. They've never won a football title.
Meanwhile, this group of folks from Parkston, they saw an awful lot of playing time through the years, and they have taken their lumps, but they turned things around this year as their only loss was to Winter in a dandy 14-7. But they had the shutouts down the stretch as well, shutting out Tri-Valley.
That's a pretty good schedule there, Mike.
Very much so.
Very challenging schedule for Parkston. They're now 10-1 on the season, and when they go into the playoffs, they beat Wagner again. They had to go. They beat Custer, and then a dandy out at St. Thomas More.
An incredible game. Our friend Patrick Duffy with the Rapid City Journal was tweeting during that game, and St. Thomas More, it was Parkston who scored on the with like a minute left to go in the third period, and then St. Thomas More chewed up over 10 minutes of clock. Parkston was thinking they were going to get the ball back. They make a stop on a fourth down. They get the ball back, and they are able to score in the last few moments on a huge, huge catch. They didn't score, but it was set up by an outstanding catch from Reef. We'll talk more about that. But in the meantime, it is time to take a closer look at the folks from Parkston as Eric Norton sat down with the folks from South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
We've had a very tough season this year. Our schedule was packed with some of the top teams in the state throughout the year. We played Canton second game of the year. We had Winter, Tri-Valley. Our conference with Wagner, Bonham, Winter again. It's been a great season. We've battled all year long, and we're happy with where we're at, and we improved all season long. We had to be ready for each and every game that we faced. We really didn't have a down week. We had to see a lot of different types of offenses and defenses, so we had to adjust, and we stayed pretty healthy throughout the entire season. So it was one of those things where it was really good for us to have to play those tough games, and it made us a better team coming into the playoffs. Our team is extremely balanced. We don't have any all-star running backs. They're all very good. And we hand the ball off and distribute it pretty equally. Defensively, kind of the same thing. We're pretty balanced all the way across. We have some outstanding players. Mitch Heisinger has played an outstanding linebacker for us. Brady Reef is on tight end, DN for us. Does a great job there, controlling sides and blocking and so on. Wes Dvorak has been, he's our quarterback, D-back. He's a punter, kicker, special teams returner. Does a little bit of everything. Great athlete, moves around well. Our line has been really solid. We have Caleb Horseman at an offensive tackle, defensive line. Austin Bertram plays offensive tackle, defensive line. Both of those guys keep on battling. And then we have Miles Semler at fullback. He also plays linebacker for us. Andrew Semler, older brother, plays another running back. He's been moved around a little bit. We started him at an offensive tackle, moved him to a running back. And he's also a corner for us. And there's, you know, a bunch of other guys, and they all play extremely well. We're happy with how we're playing as a team right now.
Well, Craig, it isn't very often that a player gets moved from offensive tackle to running back and also plays cornerback, which is predominantly reserved for the fastest player on the team. But that's what Andrew Semler has seen this year. But he's 6'3", 220, and a senior. Let's take a look at the starting lineups here for the Parkston Trojans. First of all, defensively, they will go with that 3-4 front.
Conrad, Bertram, Horseman, Stadelman, Lucas, Ganant, Brady Reef, the younger brother of Riley Reef, who's the tackle for the Detroit Lions.
No, he's the tackle for my Detroit Lions.
Oh, I'm sorry, for Mike's Detroit Lions.
And there
Lions.
You go. And Wes Dvorak, Mitch Heisinger, Andrew Semler, and Miles Semler.
Wouldn't surprise me we see Zach Scott come in also as a quarterback for Parkston.
It has been a rather unique situation. It was Scott that actually threw the pass that ended up winning the ball game. There are Bertram, Hike, Horseman, Reef, Lindemann, Heisinger, Semler.
19 interceptions, 15 sacks with this defense.
And if you are looking for somebody who is the next big thing, take a look at Brady Reef. He is 6'4", he is 215, he is being recruited in football by Nebraska, Iowa, and Michigan State. He is the third brother to win a state wrestling title. He went 44-0 last year. Of course, the state wrestling tournament's covered right here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. And the boy can play.
And then back deep, you got, of the corners and safeties, 8 interceptions among those guys right there, with Dvorak with 4 of them.
And I believe that it is illegal to have a team from Parkston without having a Murtha on the team. And so we are set to go. The Trojans and the Seahawks getting ready to kick it off here for the 11B Championship. You're watching South Dakota Public Broadcasting, and we're back after this timeout. A great crowd on hand for our second game of this Friday afternoon session with Craig Maddock and Steve Toom. I'm Mike Henriksen. Craig, 11B has provided us with some incredible games the last several years, and year in and year out, it has been the most competitive class. You take a look. Every year I say this, there are 8 or 10 teams in this class every year that you could tell me are going to win the state title, and I couldn't argue against you.
I totally agree, and all of the games have been pretty close. Winner last year, Tri-Valley, Flandreau, Tri-Valley, Aberdeen, Roncalli, Howard, Webster, just some of the schools that have won this title recently, and all of them have been pretty close games. I'm expecting the same today. I got to wonder, though, how many passes are going to get thrown, because these two teams have made it here because of their rush. Parkston has rushed for more than 3,500 yards rushing this year. They don't have a 1,000-yard rusher. Parkston, over 2,600 yards rushing. You got to wonder if anyone's going to be throwing the ball this afternoon.
Well, and yet at the same time, this is the weekend that we have now seen both Avon and West Central win their state titles by virtue of a passing touchdown. So heaven knows what's going to happen. We didn't expect Potter County to come out and throw for over 450 yards and 8 touchdowns yesterday afternoon either. So it has been very entertaining here at the Dakota Dome. And like we say, the 11B is usually one of the headliners when it comes to the quality of football that you will see. And so we are just about set to go. We are so glad that you're joining us wherever you may be. A reminder, you can follow us on Twitter at Mike Henriksen or at Craig Maddock or at SDPB Sports, as well as find us on Facebook. Let's send it down to our PA announcer and the great Joe Van Gore.
Good afternoon. The South Dakota High School Activities Association, along with its corporate partners, Sanford Health, First Premier Bank and Premier Bank Card, Farmers Union Insurance, Billion Automotive, and the South Dakota Army National Guard welcome you to the Dakota Dome here in Vermilion for the 2013 South Dakota State Class 11B Football Championship Game. Much too often, we are exposed to the examples of poor sportsmanship. That is why the South Dakota High School Activities Association is sponsoring a statewide effort to promote good sportsmanship in our schools. You can be a part of this effort by displaying good sportsmanship during the state football championship game. At this time, please turn your attention to the field for the introduction of cheerleaders from both teams. First of all, for the Canton Seahawks, Nikki Wolf, Allie Young, Justine Zylstra, Dina Hart, Kiera Hart, and Bailey Smith. And now, the cheerleaders for the Parkston Trojans. Brooklyn Schoenfelder, Bailey Teedy, Holly Kummer, Jana Holm, and Haley Belas. At this time, here is the starting offensive lineup for the team representing Region 2, the Canton Seahawks. At tight end, number 80, Bryce Schrodermeyer. At tackle, number 78, Adam Eshe. At tackle, number 77, Aaron Van Borst. At center, number 73, Tyler Lems. At guard, number 72, Josh Lasley. At guard, number 52, Andrew Estabrook. At tight end, number 45, Eli Ripley. At fullback, number 44, Tanner Broughton. At running back, number 32, Jake Ablett. At running back, number 20, Gabe Dolan. and at quarterback, number two, Cody Majors. The Seahawks, with a record of 10-1, are coached by Rich Lundstrom, assisted by Matt David, Eric Smart, Kurt Meandering, Tyler Maxwell, Shane Skiles, Todd Gannon, Andy Stephenson, and Brad Beike. And now, the starting defensive lineup for the team representing Region 3, the Parkston Trojans. At the nose, number 65, Jeff Hike. At defensive tackle, number 77, Austin Bertram. At defensive tackle, number 75, Caleb Horseman. At outside linebacker, number 43, Brady Reif. At outside linebacker, number 74, Tanner Lindemann. At inside linebacker, number 5, Mitch Heisinger. At inside linebacker, number 31, Miles Semler. At cornerback, number 36, Andrew Semler. At cornerback, number 23, Ethan Murpha. At safety, number 10, Wes Dvorak. And at safety, number 22, Lane Conrad. Parkston, with a record of 10-1, is coached by Eric Norton and assisted by Sean Spurrell, John Gilman, Chad Dodozy, Craig Bruning, and Rob Bertram. Ladies and gentlemen, your officials, as assigned by the South Dakota High School Activities Association, the referee is Andy Deinert of Mitchell, the umpire, Scott Sony of Plankington, the head linesman, Joe Schrader of Mitchell, the line judge, Kevin Deinert of Mount Vernon, and the back judge, Steve Schoenfelter of Mitchell. Fans in the rafters above the Canton Sutton section, Sergeant Jacob Bishop from the South Dakota Army National Guard will be rappelling down with today's game ball for this 11B championship game. Ladies and gentlemen, please direct your attention to midfield, where the South Dakota Army National Guard is presenting today's game ball and a ceremonial coin for excellence for the championship game coin flip. The soldiers of the South Dakota Army National Guard salute today's players, coaches, and fans for exemplifying excellence in high school activities.
Parkston won the toss and is deferring to the second half. Canton will receive.
And I just want to make a note here. Andy Deinert is the official in the white hat. He's the head of this official crew. Andy won a state championship playing for Stickney Mount Vernon back in 1999. He had a teammate on that squad that wasn't too bad. a guy by the name of Chad Greenway. But how cool is it that Andy, this is such a great story, because here's a kid that enjoyed being involved in athletics, and he knew a way to stay involved was to get involved in officiating. And he has moved up the ranks very quickly when it comes to both football and basketball, and just a great kid. Well, he's not a kid anymore. He still is to me, but great kid. And really, congratulations to all of the officials that make it here to the Dome. And we say it all the time, but it is their state championship.
But Mike, these two teams both rush the ball a lot, but they both have really good field goal kickers that can kick from a long ways out. It could come down to the kicking game later on.
And so we are set to go. The Class 11B championship game on the way. The kick will be taken by Majors at about the 10. He'll wait for it, set up on the return to the right side. He'll turn, cut it upfield, get out past the 20, and that's where the Canton Seahawks will set up. First down, 10 yards to go. Once again, Cody Majors, the 6 foot, 180-pound senior, is their quarterback. Ablett, Broughton, Dolan, they are the running backs. Schrodermeyer and Ripley are the running backs.
3,500 yards rushing as a team. They set a school record, but they don't have a 1,000-yard rusher. They distribute the ball really well.
They do indeed. So we are underway with the first play of the game. Majors will fake the handoff, go with the pitch around on the left side, and a pickup out past the 32-yard line for Gabe Dolan.
Lane Conrad was trying to fight off the block and was able to fight off the block and prevent a lot more yards downfield. Watch Conrad, number 22 for Parkston, fought off the block, able to get prevent from a first down.
Second down, 3 yards to go. Fake to the fullback. Majors drops back. He's got a man open. Caught. Coming down the near sideline. Switching the ball and out of bounds at the 22-yard line. The catch by Eli Ripley.
We told you they were going to pass a lot today, Mike. Lining up on the right side. Just a down and in on the slant. Wide open. Nice pass by Majors.
And he actually had both the Ripley and Schrodermeyer open. Ripley gets it down to the 21-yard line is where they will officially mark it. Majors now with the single setback. Send a man in motion. That's Ablett. They'll run the option. Majors turns it up. Pickup of about 4. Second down.
Parkston defensively, they're only averaging, giving up 73 yards passing a game, 128 yards rushing a game. It is a very good defense. Typically, they'll go with the 3-4, but here in this last formation, they went with 4 down linemen, went with the 4-4.
Second down, 6 yards to go.
The fullback is a 3-4 now.
Yep, fullback is Tanner Broughton. Run the sweep to the left side. That's Dolan. Dolan looks for a block. Can't find one. Good job defensively. Among the folks getting over there were Miles Semler, Andrew Semler, and more. A pickup of maybe a yard. Call it third down and 5 yards to go.
Tanner Lindemann, number 74, the first one to get there. Just coming right down the line of scrimmage. Making a nice tackle.
And Jake Ablett has checked out of the lineup. I believe he hurt a hand, an arm, maybe a shoulder. So Ablett is out. Third down and 5. Handoff to the fullback. Broughton muscles his way forward and won't get very far. Jeff Hike is a 6-foot, 300-pound junior at the nose guard position. That's where they ran straight at. And Hike did not let them get very far at all.
Here comes the field goal unit.
Yep.
Radcliffe, 2 for 5 on the field goal tries this year. His career, though, is from 46, which is a school record. This could be just a chip shot for him.
Second Radcliffe will line it up. It will be a 32-yarder. The kick is up. It is on the way. No good.
Oh, just right.
Wide right on the miss. And so the Parkston defense gives up some yardage.
Pretty sure had the leg.
It will go back over to Parkston as they will have their first possession of this game. With Craig Maddock and Steve Toome, I'm Mike Henriksen. Tune in Saturday night after the 11 AAA championship game and see Cheryl Crow. Here comes Wes Dvorak. Semler, Heisinger, or Heisinger and Semler. The handoff goes to Mitch Heisinger, and he will lose a yard.
Andy Schurz is right there, his defensive end spot. Fought off the block. It's going to be no gain at all, plus Cody Majors coming in late to help out.
They did give him a favorable spot, almost back to the line of scrimmage. So second down, 10 yards to go. Again, you talked about Parkston. This is a team that also just likes to run the ball.
Canton's 2,500 on the year.
Canton's run defense has been excellent. So strength against strength for both these squads. Second down, 10. Dvorak will keep it himself. He'll go on the sweep. He's in trouble. Now he reverses field. Gets a block. Can Majors run him down? He can, but right by the first down marker and a penalty flag down. I believe Majors might have gotten a little bit of face mask there.
Yeah, that or the horse collar. Kind of got, as Canton shot the gaps on the right side, and then Dvorak saw that, had room coming the other way, and yeah, horse collar.
Yep.
Going to be called on Majors.
Parkston was back huddling, not aware of where the ball was going to end up. Let's listen to Andy.
Horse collar on the defense.
For those of
first
you
down.
Not familiar, this is a recent move to protect players. It used to be you could grab guys up around the neck area of those shoulder pads, but they were finding that that was leading to so many injuries that that is now illegal. So you cannot grab somebody up there in the open area of the shoulder pads around the neck. That's referred to as a horse collar tackle. Handoff on the counter. Miles Semler with the carry. He'll get just into Canton territory.
Miles Semler.
Put it right on the 50.
Miles Semler, 600-yard rusher. Heisinger's almost a 700-yard rusher. Andrew Semler, about a 300-yard rusher.
Second
Let's see
down.
How they distribute it today.
Second and six. The wideouts are Lane Conrad, Brady Reef. He'll serve as alternately a wideout or a tight end. Reef is to the near side as the tight end. Handoff goes to Heisinger into the open field to the 30 and run out of bounds.
Mike Brady Reef had a huge block that let Mitch Heisinger get that big gain. Reef was set up on the near side hash mark. Number 43, big block, and that allowed Heisinger to head downfield.
So first down after the pickup of 20 yards for Mitch Heisinger. First down, 10 yards to go. The ball at the Canton 30-yard line. Again, the standard wishbone formation made famous by Oklahoma back in the 70s. On the counter, handoff Heisinger. He's got nowhere to go. He was met initially by Tanner Broughton. Broughton grabbed him, slowed him up.
Shot the gap right between Horseman and Bertram on that line. Just busted the play and then got some help by Eli Ripley to end it. Loss on the play.
So it will be second down now, 12 yards to go. Clock rolling here, under 7 minutes to play. The first quarter of action from the 11B championship game. Dvorak rolls on the right side. They'll go with the reverse. And then the throw to Reef. Wide open. Touchdown, Parkston.
Brady Reef was lined up as a tight end on the left side. Just a quick hit, and then he took off after they gave it.
Josh Rands had checked in as a wide receiver, and he came on the end around, the 6'2", 170-pound sophomore. I'm going to guess that that's his football career highlight thus far. The kick is up, and the kick is good. And so the Parkston Trojans on top of the Canton Seahawks. 7-0 our score. And we're stepping aside from the Dakota Dome in Vermilion on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. With Steve Toome and Craig Maddock, I'm Mike Henriksen. Great to have you joining us and the entire crew of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Parkston jumps on top.
Josh Rands was 1-for-2 passing in the regular season before that last touchdown pass.
The kick is away, a bounder taken by an up back. And Canton will have good field position to start as Eli Ripley, one of the up backs, will down it at the 41-yard line.
You and I have seen a lot of gadget plays.
Yeah, this weekend especially. Yeah. I can't remember a weekend, Craig, where we've seen this many.
He'll give the reverse to Rands and throws it to Reef on a team that doesn't throw the ball a lot.
And now Cody Majors is going to go out of the shotgun position. He'll drop back. He'll look downfield. Now he'll just tuck it and run, and he's going to be wrapped up after a pickup of just a couple of yards as Austin Bertram is able to contain him, give him a yard on the carry. So second down and 9. There you take a look. They were selling that out, Craig. Everybody was in the pattern.
Trying to get down to Schrodermeyer, who is doing a fly pattern down the sideline, well covered. Only a 2-yard gain for Majors.
So second down. This time they'll line up in the traditional I formation. Handoff goes to Gabe Dolan, who dots the I.
It is not going to be easy for both of these teams to be running against each other's defense because they've been so strong all year. I mean, these two teams played back in early September. Parkston won at 21-14. The defensive front seven for both Parkston and Canton are so strong that it may be a little tough go trying to go up the middle.
So it will be third down now, 6 yards to go. Handoff to the second man through. He slipped a bit. It wouldn't have mattered because the Parkston defenders were there to gobble him up. That's Bertram again, who was leading the charge. Also, Wes Dvorak had come up from his safety position to help out, and it will be fourth down. Canton will be forced to give up the ball.
So what are you going to do today? You going to set up the pass to run, or are you going to set up the run to pass?
35, Blake Beats is back. He is a freshman to receive this punt. Also over there is number 10. That's Wes Dvorak.
Lem's average is 36 yards a punt.
Good snap. Punt. Ooh, good blocking up in front of him, and a dandy punt. Dvorak at the 12, moves to his left side, and that's going to do it.
What the coverage. Great coverage.
You've heard the phrase, outkick your coverage. I thought that might be one of those punts that did, but Parkston will take over first down and 10, a return of 4 yards officially, as that ball will be marked at the 16-yard line. So the Trojans with their second possession.
Eric Norton, the head coach of Parkston, 6th year for the Trojans.
He was on the staff when they have been to the Dome before. So first down, 10 yards to go. Dvorak. The handoff, fumble. But still loose. Semler dropped it. I thought he got on it, but then he dropped it again. And it's going to belong to the Canton Seahawks in golden field position.
Bryce Schrodermeyer with the fumble recovery.
Let me tell you about Bryce Schrodermeyer. Schrodermeyer is listed at the nitro position. Everybody else is a defensive lineman or a defensive back. Schrodermeyer is at nitro. They move him all over the place, and he's just a kid that makes plays defensively.
I'm surprised more teams don't do that.
The handoff, right side, Gabe Dolan. He'll power over the right side of the line behind Josh Lasley and Adam Eshe. Pick up a couple of yards.
Dolan, an 800-yard rusher. Ablett is a 600-yard rusher. Broughton, a 560-yard rusher. Both teams just distribute the ball real well. It's tough for the other defense to try to key on one guy.
This looks so much like so many of the 11B games that we have done, Craig. Just has the same feel. Majors keeps it and should have given it up, because there to wrap him up was David Voorhees.
I don't know. I think Dolan went too far in front of Majors. He couldn't pitch it behind him because Dolan had already gone in front. He could not have pitched it back.
That's a big play by another sophomore for the Parkston Trojans. And so it will be third down now and 12 yards to go.
I enjoy watching these kind of defenses.
I do too.
I mean, they just destroy plays and cause so much havoc on offenses.
Yeah, whether it's been Winter or Tri-Valley or Aberdeen-Roncalli, there's just been so many of these types of games in 11B. Dropping back is Majors, three wide receivers. He'll take off on the left side, gets to the 20, and is pushed out of bounds at about the... did he make the 15? I believe he did. That's right underneath the bleachers on this side where we're at.
It's going to be a first down. Majors had trips to his right. Well covered. A lot of room coming to his left, and that speed able to get the first down.
Good camera work there by the crew from South Dakota Public Broadcasting. We appreciate their efforts all weekend long. It is enough for the first down. So first down, 10 yards to go. The ball at the 15-yard line. Clock stopped there as Majors had gotten out of bounds. Now Tanner Broughton, the lone setback. The pitch on the right side goes over to Niffen, and he will get to the end zone. Touchdown! Kyler Niffen, the 5'10", 170-pound senior, into the end zone from 15 yards out.
Just good blocking on that right side. And for Niffen, I'm just checking that. That's his first touchdown of the year? It is.
It is. Yep.
That's why you and I are both kind of shot.
Exactly. Niffen. I had to check and make sure that that was indeed number 33 that took it into the end zone. It was. And now Ratcliffe is on to try the extra point here. A little discussion between the officials, first of all.
Illegal participation on the defense. 12 men on the field.
Ah, that's what it was. So half the distance to the goal, which is a yard and a quarter, because the ball is set at the 2.5-yard line. Now Parkston will get their extra player off of the field. So it doesn't make much difference on the kick. Sometimes, though, in those situations, teams will decide to go for two. But Canton, this early, just going to go ahead and settle with the attempt to tie it up. The kick is up, and the kick is good. So the Trojans and the Seahawks tied at 7 apiece. Follow SDPB Sports on your mobile device all season long. Frequent updates on all South Dakota High School Championship events on Facebook and on Twitter. You can search SDPB Sports to hook up with us. Craig, how would people find you on Twitter?
Pretty simple, just at Craig Matic, M-A-T-T-I-C-K.
And where would they find KWSN Sports?
KWSN Sports.
Really?
On Twitter.
It's amazing how that works. Now, if you're looking
Thanks
to find...
Thanks for asking,
you bet. If you're looking to find me on Twitter, it would be Mike Henriksen in last name, H-E-N-R-I-K-S-E-N. And you can also find our daily radio show, Calling All Sports, by going to Marco and Mike H. By the way, Craig and I, two of the sillier people on Twitter, because of the fact we used our real names, which no one can actually spell. But again, so many great stories of people watching on their phones, watching across the country and even around the world. And we'd love to hear from you. Go ahead and hashtag SDPB Sports or mention us on Twitter. It's just great. We love hearing those stories of folks reconnecting with their home territory.
Kyler Niffen, by the way, that was his third touchdown on the season. Third touchdown for Niffen.
And so Canton will kick off. Both these teams respecting the return games. That's going to be a reverse. A pretty good
one.
And a double reverse ends up with Dvorak. Dvorak will get it out to the 30. I actually thought they had a really good wall set up over here to the near side, but they went with the double reverse. And Dvorak ends up getting the ball out to the 31-yard line.
I haven't seen a double reverse like this in a long time in Parkston. Oh, what a nice block to spring it.
Dvorak gets around. That was good coverage, really, by the Canton Seahawks.
Boy, we got to really pay attention in this game.
Indeed we do. Unlike the other games where we're just, you know, kind of riding along. Wes Dvorak out of the wishbone formation. He'll hand it off to Andrew Semler, and Semler is wrapped up at the line of scrimmage by Tyler Lems and company.
Lems, 51 tackles on the year, 9 of them for loss, and that one was a no gainer.
So second down, 10 yards to go. Lems, 3-year starter. And he's played 3 different positions, too. That's some versatility by Lems. The handoff goes to the fullback. That's Miles Semler. And Miles will muscle his way out near a first down across the 40. Not quite to the 41, which is where he needed to get for that first down. But it will be third and extremely short.
Just went right between Schurz and Van Vorst on that dive along the right side, just short of the first down.
So Wes Dvorak brings him out. He'll send Lane Conrad out wide to the left side. Reef comes to the near side. Hand off right side, and second effort is going to get the first down, but a penalty flag down. So we'll see what the call is here. Penalty flag on the play.
Canton putting two guys right on Dylan Stadelman, the center.
And it was a false start on the Parkston Trojans. So that's going to bring up a third down and short 6 for Parkston.
Each team has only been flagged once here in the first quarter.
Legal parts fiction on the offense. 5 yards.
And so it will be third down and 6 yards to go. The ball now at the 35-yard line of Parkston, and Wes Dvorak. He'll go out of the shotgun formation with a pair of backs behind him. That's Dvorak that will come in motion and end up with the football. Ball is loose. Is Canton on this one too? Let's see who got back on this. It was Dvorak who lined up as the wide receiver. Zach Scott was the man.
Dvorak got it back.
Okay, yeah, Zach Scott, who had been the starting quarterback, he lined up at the quarterback position. And Dvorak took it around the left side. He gets enough for the first down. That ball clearly comes out, bounces, falls, and Dvorak got it back. Great camera work again from the folks on the sideline. So first down for the Parkston Trojans. back to the traditional wishbone formation. Handoff goes to 37 with the carry for Parkston.
It's just tough go.
It is. Very, very tough.
Just tough go.
And that's going to do it for the first quarter. No surprise, tied at 7 in a slugfest. You're watching the Class 11B Championship on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Quarter number 2 is on the way next. With Steve Toom and Craig Maddock, I'm Mike Henriksen. The 11B Championship underway, tied at 7 apiece. And Craig, let's take a look at some of those stats.
Total yards, Parkston 94, Canton 90. And both pretty much split, almost 50-50 when it comes to passing and rushing.
So second down, 10 or 11 yards to go after the loss of a yard on that last carry. West DeVorek in at the quarterback position. West 6'2", 170 and a junior. He's got Josh Rands as one of the wideouts. This time DeVorek will keep it himself. Spring to the outside, gets away from the man. Down the sideline he goes. Cuts it back inside. And is dropped down at the 12-yard line. Coming up with the tackle was Anders Peterson. But big damage done by West DeVorek.
He got some great blocking down the sideline. Look at that line move him out of the way and just clear space.
And great speed, too. He was second in wrestling at 145 last year, also an outstanding hurdler.
Gabe Dolan tried to wrap him up down the sideline, but DeVorek gets a big play for the Trojans.
First down, 10 yards to go. Handoff goes to the fullback. That's Miles Semler, and Semler will pound ahead for a couple. Running into the heart of that defense, Aaron Van Voorst and Austin Schurz, Tyler Lems up across that front line.
Biggest plays we've seen, Mike, has been going outside the tackles.
Yeah, you're right. You brought it up. Both teams running basically a three-man front, and both three-man fronts are so solid. Second down now, 7. The handoff on the counter. Heisinger to the right side.
Fumble.
Fumble.
Oh.
Ball loose.
Canton got it. Picked up by Austin Schurz.
Schurz comes up with the ball. Canton with the big defensive play.
Just ripped him out of his arms.
Heisinger on the right side, stood up, and then there's Schurz stripping it away. Ball comes out in midair. Canton football. They've got it at their own 7-yard line. The handoff to the second man through, that's Dolan. And he won't get far. Or excuse me, no, that was 23, excuse me.
Yeah, 33. Niffen,
yeah,
with the carry. Yeah, Niffen is, he got the touchdown. He caused a fumble in another possession. He's been all over the place here early in this ballgame.
So second down. Hand off, Dolan, left side. Got a little bit of a crease, but that closed in a heartbeat as he gets out to the 10-yard line. And that will bring up a third down. Call it 7 yards to go.
David Voorhees, Andrew Semler on the tackle for Parkston. Parkston defensively only given up 6 points a game.
Yeah, both these teams have just been terrific defensively.
Nice shot there. Rich Lundstrom. 12th year at Canton.
Burdell Coplin for so many years was the head coach, and as a matter of fact, this year Canton did something they hadn't done since Coplin was the head coach, and that was beat West Central. Majors keeps it himself, looks for a block, and will not get the first down. So the Parkston defense with a nice job after giving up the ball. Depending on the punt here, they should get the ball back in pretty good field position.
Tyler Lems will go from the center spot to be the punter. Averages 36 yards a punt. Parkston should get some pretty good field position here.
Dropping back is Blake Beats.
Don't see too many centers dropping back to be your punter.
No, not very often.
He's got a great leg, though.
Beats and Dvorak are back. That punt is a dandy. That goes, drives Dvorak back to the 42. Gets it out into Canton territory at the 48-yard line.
Schrodermeyer in coverage on the stop.
Nice return there for the Trojans. They will take over inside Canton territory. Craig, you talked about it in the pregame. Kicking game going to be huge in this, not just from a field goal standpoint, but from that field position standpoint.
Yeah, Lems and Dvorak are both really good punters for both clubs. Lems for Canton and Dvorak is the punter and the place kicker for Parkston. Both these guys got strong legs. And, of course, Ratcliffe is the place kicker for Canton. Even though he missed a 32-yarder earlier, he can certainly hit from close to 50.
Yeah, distance wasn't the issue for him on that miss. Handoff goes on the right side to Andrew Semler. Semler gets it inside the 45, just shy of the 44-yard line.
Both teams have only thrown the ball once. They've completed both.
Yeah, and they did them on their first possession. They really had us scared there for a while that they were both going to come out and start throwing the ball around, but that is completely not who these teams are. Clock continuing to roll here in the first half. Canton and Parkston in what has so far been a typical Class 11B game. Lots of running and lots of defense.
Rands back in the game here for Parkston at the bottom of your screen.
Dvorak. Handoff. And again, just nothing doing against Van Vorst and Tyler Lambs up front.
Schurz.
So third down now. 6 yards to go. Of course, the Dakota Dome in Vermilion going to be hosting. I'm trying to think of the right word. Let's just go with several thousand. I was going to try to think of some descriptive word to describe the number of people that will be in this dome tomorrow. And a good crowd on hand today. And they're getting loud. Shotgun formation. Handoff. Nope. Pass. They'll throw on the right side for Reef. Intercepted. Eli Ripley comes up with the interception. Man-to-man coverage on Brady Reef. And with 6:39 left to play here in this first half of action, Trojans 7, Seahawks 7. Canton with the ball when we come back on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. With Steve Toome and Craig Maddock, I'm Mike Henriksen. And Craig, this doesn't happen to Dvorak very often.
Only his third pick of the year, the second one for Ripley, the safety for Canton, just going up. That one just kind of thrown up there. Jump ball, and Ripley got it.
Normally you like your chances with Brady Reef going up in a jump ball situation, but excellent position by Ripley. And so turn the ball back over to the Canton Seahawks. Cody Majors with the I formation. Handoff, Gabe Dolan over the left side. He'll burst through for about six. Second down, 4 yards to go. Clock rolling now, under 6.5 minutes to play in the first half of action.
15 rushing plays for Canton. Majors, 5 carries for 18. Niffen, 2 for 15. Dolan, 5 for 14. Total of 56 yards rushing on the, so far in the first half for the Seahawks.
Both teams, yards have been tough to come by. Again, straight eye formation with Gabe Dolan dotting the eye. Dolan, left side, got a block, and he will run through the defender to pick up the first down. Coming up to meet him was David Voorhees, the sophomore defensive back. He made a nice play earlier, but that time he just got out-muscled. And enough for the first down for Canton.
Only the fourth first down in the game for Canton.
So first down, 10 yards to go. Clock will roll here now that the chains are set. And again, eye formation. Tanner Broughton is the fullback. He'll get it on the counter play. Broughton out near the 45-yard line. A pickup of 7. And a big carry that time by Broughton. Both these teams just hitting hard. Eshe, Lasley, Lems, Estabrook, Van Vorst, the offensive line for Canton. Horseman, Hike, Bertram, they're the front line defenders for Parkston. So second down, call it 2 yard line, or 2 yards. And that time, Majors is going nowhere. Coming up with the tackle is Andrew Semler.
He was in the right place at the right time. He did what your safety's supposed to do, get to the outside, preventing any type of a rush, trying to force him to go inside, but
he
ran right into Majors.
Just in perfect position. First of all, he played the pitch and made sure that the pitch couldn't go to Dolan, and then he wraps him up for the tackle. A big play on second down. So now third down. And a false start on the Canton offense. So that's going to
be a little ugly there.
Yep, now that's going to bring up third down and about 12.
Majors is 1 for 1 passing, 47 yards. That was early in the game.
False start on the offense, 5-yard penalty.
Congratulations earlier to the Avon Pirates picking up the perfect season with Coach Tom Culver and company. So third down, a long 11.
There's a shot of Eric Norton, the head coach of Parkston.
Majors will go out of the shotgun. He'll drop back, throw back on the left side of the screen to Schurz. Into the, past the stick, but only to the 40-yard line. So that's going to be not near enough for the first down. He'll come up about 7 yards short. And that will bring up a punting situation for the Canton Seahawks as the clock now goes under 4 minutes.
Miles Semler was committed on the blitz, but you know what happened? The rest of the Parkston defenders stayed at home. They didn't flow to one side. They kind of stayed at home and thus allowing not a big gain.
Dvorak is back along with Blake Beats. The snap is a good one. The punt is away from Dvorak. Takes a nice Canton bounce, but Dvorak will field it. He's trapped, gets out of there somehow, and now has some room. Gets a huge block and goes down the sideline. Just pushed out of bounds. Wow, what a return by Wes Dvorak.
Austin Bertram of Parkston was the guy that opened it up, number 77. Watch him here right at the top of your screen. There's the block coming up by 77 by Bertram, and lets Dvorak go down the sideline.
And Dvorak was finally run out of bounds by Josh Lasley. And I got to think, if I'm Josh, I'm real happy I got the angle on that. So first down and 10 inside Canton territory. Dvorak calls the starting count. He's never in any hurry at that line of scrimmage. He'll pitch on the sweep left, and that goes nowhere. Well read defensively.
Eli Ripley, Tyler Lems, bottom of the pile, Gabe Dolan for the Canton Seahawks.
So it will be second down now and 11 as the clock goes under 3 minutes to play.
They got to go about another 20 yards if they want to get into field goal territory.
Both teams with all three timeouts left. Miles Semler now will go back into the backfield. They'll go into that traditional wishbone offense. And a timeout going to be called by West of Oregon.
I think there was confusion on the play because Miles Semler, I don't think, was supposed to be lined up there in the wishbone. And Dvorak eventually called the timeout, which I think is a good timeout.
Hey, coming up on Sunday, join South Dakota Public Broadcasting for the premiere of the Gettysburg Story 150 years later. America's greatest battle is recounted as you've never seen it before. That comes up Sunday at 3 Central and 2 Mountain. And how appropriate is that? Because Potter County picked up their first state title yesterday. And for those of you that don't know, Gettysburg is, of course, involved with Potter County, as is Hoban. But Gettysburg was actually settled by a bunch of veterans who had been in the Battle of Gettysburg. And if you ever have a chance to swing through Gettysburg, not that it's on the way necessarily, but it's worth looking at, they have got a war memorial that is just outstanding, including honoring the Gettysburg veterans. So see how South Dakota Public Broadcasting ties into all things? It's just amazing. That comes up Sunday afternoon. Second down, 11 yards to go. Wishbone formation. Dvorak. Hands off. Heisinger. Heisinger will get about four or five running off the right tackle. But again, the clock continuing to roll now at 2:15 left to play in this first half.
Again, Spencer Lucas, the big 6'4", 200-pound senior there on the lead block. The Canton defensively not allowing a lot of yards on the ground. Let's see, Parkston, 113 yards rushing here in the first half.
Turnovers, however, have harmed them. A big third down here. Dvorak gets blown up in the backfield. Oh, my, what a play. Defensive lineman Tyler Lems and others just absolutely, that play had no chance, and all the way back to the 48-yard line, a fourth down.
Yeah, loss of almost 10, Mike.
Tanner Broughton was in. Take a look at that. That just goes nowhere. That was one off a defensive line overpowering an offensive line, and I can bet you that that hasn't happened to the Parkston offensive line very often this year. Clock will now go under a minute before this punt gets off.
Watch a fake here?
I don't think so.
Thought about it.
They looked, but that ball is going to bounce down inside the 10. Clock will be at 39 seconds. Let's see what Kent decides to do here.
Yeah, Dvorak stood there for about 2 seconds before he kicked it, wondering if there was anybody open to throw to.
He had no pressure. And so it will be first down and 10 for Canton. Is Rich Lundstrom just going to go ahead and take the knee here?
I would just run plays. You're not going to want to. The way these defenses are playing,
you don't want to
throw up an interception.
Yep, exactly.
Right now.
Yep, the turnover or anything along those lines. It was tied at 7 at the end of one. No, he's not going to take the knee.
Rip one here.
Hand off on the counter. They'll go to Broughton. Broughton will get it out to the almost a first down pickup of 10, and the clock will stop as they look to move the chains.
It is a first down.
But Canton not going to call a timeout. So once the chains are set, Rich going to be conservative here. If he can break one, he breaks one, but with one of his players. But in the meantime, he will pocket those timeouts. Man in motion. And Reef blew that one up, but Schurz comes out of there somehow, and he gets another first down. So that will stop the clock with 15 seconds left to go.
Well, Coach Lundstrom's going to take a timeout here.
Two nice pickups here. Suddenly has them in position. Brady Reef did a great job of turning that in, but nobody wrapped up Schurz.
And Parkston playing a little bit back.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no
well.
Question. No question about it. So it will be, and they're going to actually measure this to make sure. But again, the timeout was taken anyway. Coming up at halftime, I believe we've got some awards to be handing out.
And Josh Rands, a pass to Brady Reef. Parkston get on the board on a six-play, 80-yard drive. As you see, the first down. Then Canton got on the board. Kyler Niffen, 15 yards out, getting the score. All tied up at seven.
Coming up tonight, the 11AA championship.
Yeah, this place is full. Nice crowd.
Yeah,
today.
Great crowd today.
We'll have a bunch from Pier and Watertown tonight.
Yes, we will. And then tomorrow night, the biggest of the big schools, Sioux Falls Roosevelt and Sioux Falls Lincoln.
What's Coach Lundstrom going to do here? You don't call a timeout just to put a knee down here. Does he have something interesting?
Well, we've seen just about every other trick play so far this weekend. Might as well see one more. The pitch, the inside counter. The handoff up the middle, and another first down. That will stop the clock at the 7-second mark.
Well, now you can throw up a Hail Mary if you want, see what happens.
Gabe Dolan ended up with the carry, and so now Rich Lundstrom will use another timeout. And I agree, Craig. Now suddenly you're in a position back when you're at the 7-yard line. There was no point heaving one up, but right here, with only 7 seconds left, you might as well.
Little inside counter handoff there. And
that was a play that Del Rapids has run a few times over the course of the years. There will be some folks that remember the looking at the backside of a barber brother as that little counter would either Zach or Channing. Let's take a look. Cody Majors, again, 576 yards. On throwing the ball.
700 yards rushing.
Yep. He's the first Canton Seahawk over 300 yards from scrimmage in his career. And the funny thing is, he broke the previous record, which was held by Devin Skiles, and Devin is now the statistician.
Uh-oh.
Come on, Devin. Couldn't you fudge a few of those numbers? Keep that record yourself, my friend. So first down.
You got trips here to the near side, Mike. Right next to the tight end, you got trips.
Majors will drop back. He's got time. Throws, caught, out of bounds. 2 seconds left. The catch is made by Eli Ripley.
Now you got to throw it deep. You can't throw it 10 yep. yards down. Now is when you got to
They were fortunate there. So, but the ball will be at the 49-yard line.
And one more timeout here. This would be like Schrodermeyer territory, and maybe the heave and the hoe, Dolan, Schrodermeyer. You know, they had trips set up on that last play. I would assume they may try to do that again on the next snap.
I was just trying to look. A timeout is called. That's going to be by the Seahawks. They will use their last one. The clock stopped because the runner went out of bounds. But again, Rich Lundstrom wanting a little bit more time.
Just like the score, stats are pretty close too. Canton, 159 yards of total offense. Parkston, 143. Number of plays, 24 plays for Canton, 20 for Parkston.
Of course, Parkston has turned the ball over. So now, empty backfield. And Majors will go out of the shotgun position.
Jennings and Ripley split wide to the bottom of your screen, and they'll put Schrodermeyer at the top of your screen.
Shades of winter Tri-Valley a few years back, although from farther out. We'll find out what kind of arm Majors has here. Pressure from Reef, and Reef will gobble him up, and we will not find out what kind of an arm Cody Majors has.
Reef from that outside linebacker spot. He came in on the blitz on the backside, and how about that? Tied here at halftime.
And so we are at halftime, tied at 7 apiece. That was the score at the end of the first quarter as well. And Steve Toome is standing by. He'll have Rich Lundstrom here in just a moment. As a matter of fact, he's ready to go. So let's send it down to our compatriot from South Dakota Public Broadcasting, Steve Toome.
All right, thanks, guys. Coach, there you tried to work a play there in the last few moments trying to get down the field. What did you have in mind?
Oh, a little trickery. haven't run it in a game ever, but thought we'd try it, and I would probably never run it again.
Coach, your defense has been very opportunistic here in the first half.
Yeah, they've been doing it all year, and we expected that. We just got to step up on offense.
Now, what have you seen from your team that you've liked, and what do you need to improve on here in the second half?
Obviously, I like how the defense is playing. Offensively, we need to improve our blocking, obviously. We're not getting to the linebackers very well. We're not staying on our blocks. We're getting thrown too easily, and we got to improve that.
Coach, good luck in the second half.
Thank you.
Rich Lundstrom, the head man for the Canton Seahawks. It's halftime here. It's the 11B championship game. We're back in a moment. This is South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Free statewide broadcast of this South Dakota High School Sports Championship is underwritten by the thousands of members of the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, by Mid-Continent Communications, and by Dakota Bank.
With Steve Toome and Craig Maddock, I'm Mike Henriksen. Let's send it down to our PA announcer for the afternoon, Joe Van Gore.
Fans, we direct your attention to the field. South Dakota sports fans were stunned in 1988 when Doug Custer appeared, collapsed, and died while officiating the 11B championship game here in the Dakota Dome. Custer was a fine official, a devoted husband, and a good father to his three children, but he still had time to contribute to church and community activities. In memory of Doug Custer, and in an effort to recognize the contributions which officials make not only to high school sports, but to their community as a whole, the South Dakota High School Officials Association has established an award to recognize a deserving official for his contributions. Reggie Olson is the 2013 recipient. Reggie began his officiating career in 1982. He has officiated countless basketball games for both boys and girls. He has been active in sports for as long as he can remember. He participated in baseball, football, track, and softball, and has officiated at some level in each of those sports. Reg is one of the founders of the Entringer Scholarship Classic and has helped raise over $500,000 since its inception for students. He has been more than willing to help with items both on and off the court. He has graciously given his talent in the singing of the national anthem at every Entringer Classic. Reggie feels privileged to be selected to work a nine-man championship in 1986, 2000, and 2011. Congratulations, Reggie, and thank you for your unselfish contributions. Accepting the award for Reggie is daughter Amber and son Dustin. Presenting the award is Lewis Young. A complete bio for Reggie can be found in the football playoff program. Again, the Doug Custer Award to Reggie Olson.
And back at the Dakota Dome with Craig Maddock and Steve Toom, we are awaiting the presentation of the Band of the Day Award to the Warner Monarch Band, who just does such a tremendous job. That's Wayne Carney, who's standing over there waiting for the PA to announce that for him.
How many overtime games have we had in Class 11B?
I don't know, Craig. How many?
One.
Really?
Wagner and Hamlin back in 82. That's been the only overtime game in Class 11B.
That long?
Yeah.
Well, we've had a lot that were close. We've had a lot that came down right to it. The end, I remember a few years ago, Flandreau winning that game over Mobridge Pollock. There's still a lot of people that aren't sure how that extra point got over. Now here's Joe Van Gore.
Wayne Carney, Executive Director of the South Dakota High School Activities Association, is presenting a Band of the Day plaque to the Warner High School Band under the direction of Sharon Schwann. Please give them a round of applause for the fine entertainment they have provided in this session of the State High School Football Championships.
Before we get back to football, well, we'll tell you about the Warner Band when we come back, because they're just terrific. An outstanding music program, just one of the many extracurriculars sponsored by the South Dakota High School Activities Association. Halftime, Trojans and Seahawks tied at 7. We're back to the Dome after this.
All right, we're back at halftime here with Eric Norton, the head coach for Parks. The coach, take us through that first, their one touchdown play there that went to Brady Reif.
It was a play we've been working on for a little while now, and we kind of wanted to get a good start. That was a good way for us to get up and, have a little fun with football, too.
Well, turnovers have been a problem for your team here. You had a couple drives stalled by fumbles.
Yeah, if you get rid of those fumbles, it's been a pretty positive half for us. We got to be able to hang on to the ball, control what we need to do, and we'll probably be all right.
What did you talk to your team at the halftime about as far as improvements in the second half?
We need to make some blocking assignment changes, and we needed to adjust a few things. But the big thing was, hey, we're still in this game. We haven't had our best half of the season, so we have a good opportunity in the second half.
Coach, thank you for your time and good luck.
Thank you.
Eric Norton, the head football coach for the Parkston Trojans. Let's send it back upstairs to Craig Maddock and Mike Henriksen.
Thank you very much, Steve Toome. There you get a good look at one of the a good large group on hand today for this 11B game. Of course, a lot of folks stuck around after the 9B game as well. Let's take a look at some stats and some highlights. The Parkston student section right there.
There are a lot of close stats with this ball game, Mike. When you look at these highlights, we've seen the halfback pass. Actually, it was almost a wide receiver reverse into the half in the pass to Brady Reef.
Reef with the touchdown there to put Parkston on the board and take the 7-0 lead.
That was from Josh Rands, by the way. And then a couple of fumbles have really hurt Parkston.
Those have been very, very big. They have gotten some good yardage, but there you see on an outstanding run by Niffen into the end zone to tie the ball game.
Yeah, Kyler gets his third touchdown of the year. And then late, the interception picked off, stalling another drive. And there's where we're at, all tied at 7.
And so at halftime, oh, one more, as Majors will get wrapped up by Brady Reef to end the first half. So at halftime, tied at 7 apiece. First downs, even. Rushing yards, pretty even. Passing yards, pretty even. Total yards, guess what? Pretty even. Biggest difference, those turnovers. So far in this first half. With Craig Maddock, I'm Steve Toome. We're back to the Dakota Dome right after this timeout on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Free statewide broadcast of this South Dakota High School Championship event is brought to you in part by the thousands of members of the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, by Farmers Union Insurance, by SDN Communications, and by the Independent Insurance Agents of South Dakota.
With Steve Toome and Craig Maddock, I'm Mike Henriksen. Just to wrap things up there on the Warner Band, Warner has one of the greatest participation percentages of band of any high school in the country. Their junior high band is huge. Their high school band has been outstanding, and again, with great numbers. And that's when we talk about the South Dakota High School Activities Association. Remember, there are schools that actually have high school athletic associations. That's not the case in South Dakota. It's about all the activities, and South Dakota Public Broadcasting does such a wonderful job of covering those, whether it be, you know, the arts or the athletics, you name it. You're going to find great coverage at SDPB. Craig, we're a minute away from kickoff here in the second half. Keys to the second half for each of these squads.
Well, you heard Rich Lundstrom of Canton and Eric Norton of Parkston with Steve Toome during the halftime. They both said they needed the block better. They needed different blocking assignments. They weren't picking up blocks. That will spawn the running game. If you get your assignments done, get the right blocking, you're going to get some guys breaking off. I don't think they're going to change a darn thing, but they are. They both talked about during halftime blocking assignments and picking up the blocks. We'll see if that's pretty tough to do when you got two really good defenses.
And Parkston's got to come up, you know, they got to take better care of the ball, too. Three turnovers in that first half for the Parkston Trojans.
By the way, that
and an interception.
That Monarch band, they will all be busy next week because they got state volleyball.
Oh, sure.
Next week, as they will be watching their team, the number one ranked team in Class B.
Wait a minute. Warner High School is going to the state volleyball tournament?
Yes, they are. They
really?
Won it again.
That's
won it all
of a,
last
kind
year.
Of a rarity for them, isn't it?
Well, you got, and you'll see it all on South Dakota Public Broadcasting next weekend. The double A's are in Mitchell at the Corn Palace, the A's in Aberdeen, the B's in Huron.
And by the way, yes, I kid. I know that Warner was outstanding last year, and every year.
Remember, they didn't lose
Warner,
a set last
exactly.
Year?
It's either Warner or Northwestern from that part of the world that are just always among the best high school volleyball teams in the state of South Dakota.
Mike, so far individually, nobody over 100 yards rushing. Dvorak for Parkston, 4 carries for 58. Gabe Dolan leads Canton, 8 carries for 38. On the passing end, Cody Majors, 3 for 3 and 61 yards for Canton. Parkston, Josh Rand, 1 for 1 for 32 yards in that touchdown. Meanwhile, Dvorak, 0 for 1, 1 pick.
The Parkston Trojans will get the football to start this second half of action. With Steve Toome from South Dakota Public Broadcasting and Craig Maddock from Sioux Falls Sports Radio, KWSN. I'm Mike Henriksen from SportsMax Radio and from our daily show, Calling All Sports. Delighted to have you with us on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Lots of men and women working very hard to bring you this production this weekend. And so the kick is away. Again, a low bounder. That's loose. A live ball. Who's on it? I think Parkston fell on it. One of the up players. Yep. Coming up with it for Parkston was number 55. That's Dylan Stadelman. And so
that was
fortunate. Very fortunate.
Parkston has had three fumbles. They've lost two of them. Of course, that one would not necessarily be a turnover, not caused a fumble, just a loose ball.
And so Wes Dvorak will bring him out. Lane Conrad is wide to the right side. Brady Reif is the tight end on the left side. Wishbone formation. Semler, and Heisinger. Running back by Law Firm. Handoff goes to Heisinger on the right side. He'll get a block from Andrew Semler. And pick up about 4 yards, second down and 6. And so it will be second down, just underway here in the third period. Congratulations to Avon, to Potter County. Avon win over Hamlin earlier today was one for the ages, a terrific football game. West Central's win over Madison last night, a terrific football game. Bridgewater Emory Ethan able to pick up another state title yesterday afternoon. Handoff, Heisinger running the right side. He'll have the first down. He gets it down to the 40-yard line, and it will be first down for the Parkston Trojans.
Yeah, they're just going off that right side. You got Caleb Horseman, the guard, Austin Bertram, the tackle. They're just following those guys. They had Reef on that side as well, the tight end. Typically, wherever Brady Reef goes on the tight end, that's where they're going to be running.
The tackle by Bryce Schrodermeier. Schrodermeier playing the nitro position. They just kind of move him around in that defense. First down, 10 yards to go. Handoff goes to Miles Semler, and Miles Semler will muscle his way forward for about 12 yards and another first down, down to the 28-yard line of the Canton Seahawks.
The basic quick dive, and he got hurt too, Mike, as he tried to get up, but hurt on that play, his fifth carry and 36 yards rushing, but he got hurt at the end of that play.
He's looking at that lower leg, lower left leg. Miles Semler, chance to tell you a little bit about him. He was another member of that state champion wrestling team. He came up with the huge play at the end of the game against St. Thomas More with an interception to ice that game. What a game that was, too. You know, Craig, St. Thomas More was so close to being here. Winner could have just as well have been here. Aberdeen-Roncalli, a terrific game.
It was wide open.
Yeah, and again, that's the balance that you find in 11B. But we've got two teams here that are evenly matched. You saw the stats. You saw everything else that went along with it. Hey, by the way, I just want to take a moment and thank the coaches and the non-coaches, the other folks that have provided us background information on some of these players. It's really our chance to highlight some of these kids. For some of these kids, this is going to be obviously their athletic, you know, the peak of their athletic career. But for other kids, you just never know if this is, you know, their only chance in the spotlight. And so anytime that the coaches or folks like Jim Aker in Parkston or whoever it may be provide us with background information, we are so appreciative. because we really want to highlight these kids as much as we can. So first down, 10 yards to go after the 12-yard pickup. Dvorak will keep it himself, tiptoe his way back into the middle of the line and not get very far. He is wrapped up by Alex DeYoung, the 6'1 freshman who is in there playing due to an injury. But a nice tackle by DeYoung.
Yeah, DeYoung is getting the start because Jaden Broughton, the brother of Tanner, tore his ACL in that winter game. So the freshman getting his first start in a state championship game.
Wow. How cool is that? Second down, 9 yards to go officially. Handoff. Heisinger, right side, picks up just 2 or 3 yards. Gets it inside the 25, shy of the 24-yard line.
Again, Mike, they love that right side. Horseman.
A little power football.
The guard, Bertram, the tackle. They're both juniors. I mean, that line for Parkston that we're talking about, one senior.
Yeah.
And that's Lucas. You know, he's one of the guards. Everybody else is a junior, and they got Wes Gannett, the sophomore. So that's a pretty young offensive line.
So third down here, a long 6. And is that Zach Scott into quarterback? I believe it is. Yep, Zach Scott is the quarterback. He's under pressure from a blitz. Gets away, throws over the head of his intended receiver, Wes Dvorak. They bring Zach Scott in. He is a better passer, and he was actually their starting quarterback a year ago. When they do that, they move Wes Dvorak, the quarterback, out to wide receiver. But it is not successful picking up yardage that time, and so it brings up a fourth down.
Field goal try maybe here. Yep.
This would be a 42-yarder, and it's going to be Dvorak.
He has his longest this year has been 30. He has tried from 53 but missed.
Dvorak, 6'2", 170 in the junior, out of the hold of Zach Scott. Ball is down. The kick is up. Wide left. Boy, we've seen plenty of leg here on both these guys,
yes.
These kickers, but one was wide right for Canton and one was wide left for Parkston. So nothing doing on the opening drive for the Parkston Trojans, and now Canton will take over. First down and 10, their first possession of this second half.
May not be the last time we see Dvorak try a field goal or Radcliffe with a field goal with Canton. The way this game has been going all day, it could come down to one of those kicks at the end.
So Cody Majors has the full house backfield. Handoff. Swarming defense there. Miles Semler and others in on the tackle.
That time Canton was going off the right side where they got Andrew Estabrook, the guard, Aaron Van Vorst, the tackle.
By the way, good to see Miles Semler back in the ballgame. He came out here recently.
Talked about the youth of the Parkston offensive line. How about Canton? Lem's the senior center. Estabrook is a senior. The rest of the line, all juniors.
Brian Jennings will check into the lineup for the Canton Seahawks.
Majors able to pick up that fumble.
Very fortunate.
As you would call, Mike, in several calls, a fortuitous buzz.
That's right. Yep, that was just plain lucky, which is another way of putting it. But third down here for Canton. Again, defensive struggle is what we expected between these two teams. Running the ball, just trying to outmuscle the other one. Who's going to wear down? That will be big as we move into the middle of this third quarter.
Canton's got to hurry up here. They're going to get called for delay of game. 5, 4, 3.
I'm not sure Majors sees it.
1.
Yeah, just got it off. Majors, the screen on the left side. That's caught by Jennings. Jennings just checked into the lineup. He catches the pass and gets the first down on the throwback screen.
That could have been a lot more, Mike, but David Voorhees of Parkston had three guys blocking him, and he was able to fight them all off for a minimal gain. I mean, they still got the first down, but he was able to get his hand up there.
Very nice tackle, but it was enough for the first down. So the clock rolling now at 7:13, ball sitting at the 32-yard line. Now the clock has stopped, is an equipment issue, I assume, for the Canton Seahawks.
Well, that's the center, Tyler Lems. I don't know if he's got blood. I think he's got a bloody nose. He's had to come out.
Chase Beitzel will check into the lineup, 5'10", 235, and a junior.
Oh, they're going to have to blow a timeout here.
You don't want to be doing that when you are in a tight ball game, but good decision by Rich. You don't want to spend it, but it's well spent because this gives Rich Lundstrom a chance to have his center, actually, Beitzel, warm up and practice the snaps with Cody Majors. That's what he's doing over there on the sideline. So, like I said, you don't want to, but this one, that'll work out. Yep, that's Jake Ablett, who is on the sideline. That's why we've seen so much of Niffen, of Schurz, of Jennings.
Don't like to see that.
Hate to see it.
Jake, 665-yard rusher. Big part of that Canton offense that rushed for more than 3,500 yards, a school record, but nobody over 1,000 yards.
And that's just amazing to me because, you know, you have individuals this year that went over 2,000 yards. Who were those individuals? Well, you can find out at SDSportsHistory.com. So first down, power eye formation. We haven't seen this lineup yet for the Canton Seahawks. Handoff goes to the eye back. That's Dolan. He'll bite off about 7 yards on that carry.
That was a successful power eye. We might see that again. Has not been easy to go between the tackles against Parkston today. And yep. Now Lems back in as center for Canton.
It is tough to run against Jeff Hike, who, by the way, his name's Hike. Shouldn't he be the center? He is 6 foot and a 300-pound junior at that nose guard. There's the handoff. Dolan on the left side. He'll pick up enough for the first down out to the 43-yard line. Another first down for the Canton Seahawks. But Hike and Bertram, they have been tough to run against inside. Now Canton starting to get some
Gabe Dolan
movement off tackle. But, yeah, Dolan hobbling off. As Kyler Niffen will check into the lineup. Kyler has the only touchdown of the day there.
Yep, could tell he felt that right away.
He's going to get some assistance on the sideline. First down, 10 yards to go. Hand off. Niffen.
Oh.
Niffen got just out past the 45-yard line. And then in what rather appropriately looked like a wrestling move, both these schools, terrific wrestling programs.
That was Caleb Horseman with the takedown. Here he comes.
Grab him and yank him down.
That was a good move there by Caleb. We've seen just hard to pinpoint one defensive player.
It has been.
On both these teams. I mean, there are just so many good defensive players.
Clock continuing to roll. Now under 5.5 minutes to play. Hand off on the counter. That will go to Broughton, and Broughton will get up just shy of the 50-yard line.
Horseman with another stop. Miles Semler, the linebacker, coming in to assist.
This is going to bring up a big third down. Checking back into the lineup is Chase Beitzel. Beitzel will come in, and Lassley will take a seat.
Yeah, Lassley is the guard, so Beitzel's going in as a guard. So he was a center here just a couple of snaps ago.
Broughton is the fullback. Handoff, Schurz. Nice job of patience and a first down. Waited for his blockers and burst past the line of scrimmage. A first down for the Canton Seahawks as this clock continues to roll.
His third carry of the game, had 12 yards going into this rush, and he picked up almost 12 just on that carry.
And that's so tough to teach a high school running back, is wait for those blocks and be patient. Well, he was, and he was well rewarded.
182 yards total offense here for Canton, 115 on the ground.
Hand off, Broughton gets out to the 40-yard line.
Now, I've not had a score since late first quarter.
And I'm correct on this, aren't I, Craig? This is Canton's first possession of this second half. Parkston marched it down, missed the field goal. Then Canton got the ball at the 20. So this,
you are correct,
is a time-consuming drive by the Canton Seahawks. Ball at the 40-yard line. Cody Majors, the senior quarterback. And a penalty flag down. I think that's going to be a false start. Yep. It will be a false start. Illegal procedure on the Canton Seahawks.
Their third of the day.
False start on the offense. 5 yards.
Schurz coming back in now for Canton with the play. Jennings going out.
Got a nice note earlier today from Mitchell, South Dakota. We certainly appreciate that note. We appreciate all the notes that we're getting from around the country.
Here comes that power eye again, Mike.
They'll hand off to Broughton fullback dive. And taking the brunt of that was Ethan Murtha.
Yeah.
but he ends up coming up with the tackle. He was knocked backwards, but still, now another third down for the Canton Seahawks.
Don't have any stats here with us what third down conversion rates have been today, but I would assume they haven't been very good. Not a lot of third down conversions today. Well, I take that back. There have been some
plays
here, but this
Majors will go out of the shotgun. He'll drop back on the right side. The throwback screen goes over to Dolan, who's back in the lineup. He's open, gets a block, down the sideline, gets another block, stays inbounds, inside the 5-yard line, but a penalty flag down.
That might be a face mask near the end.
Gabe Dolan had checked out of the lineup. He had come out limping here recently, but he was back in that time.
Boy, Tyler Lem's the center.
It is a face mask against Parkston.
Tyler Lem's the center.
Face mask, defense, half the distance to the goal, first down.
After he snapped it, he set up that screen and he led the way in the blocking. Look at number 73, he's going downfield. He was able to cut down Voorhees.
And then he makes another block against Dvorak. So Canton with first and goal. Dolan in the offset eye formation. Majors hands it to Broughton, and Broughton stays on his feet but isn't able to escape that pursuit. Defensively in on the play, Andy Semler and others. Lane Conrad came up to help out.
We've talked about how tough it is to run between the tackles. Let's see if Canton maybe tries to go on a sweep.
Second down and goal to go. No score since late in that first period, as Craig just mentioned a couple of moments ago. Time the full house backfield. Handoff left side,
nice,
into the end zone. Touchdown, Austin Schurz.
Just going off the left side. Adam Eshi with a big block.
Well, Austin has been one of the best 300-meter hurdlers in the state the last couple of years, but no need to hurdle the line that time. Good blocking. And the Canton Seahawks have taken the lead. The snap, the kick. Just snuck in the left upright. And so with 2:06 left to play in the third period, Canton on top of Parkston. We're back after this timeout on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. With Steve Toome of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, Craig Maddock of Sioux Falls Sports Radio, KWSN. I'm Mike Henriksen of SportsMax Radio and Calling All Sports. Canton on top of the Trojans, 14-7.
That was a six-minute drive, almost 7 minutes. Each team has had the ball once in the third quarter.
The kick is away. This one time they will send it deep, and Dvorak will take it at the 12. Run up the middle and get it out to the 27-yard line. Mark it at the 28 by the time they get it marked, and so that's where Parkston will take over, trailing in the game for the first time this afternoon.
Here's Parkston's stats, 171 yards of total offense, most of that on the ground. 139 yards rushing, but Dvorak had 42 yards of that on a long run. Otherwise, it's been pretty tight.
So first down, 10 yards to go. This time, they'll go with the offset I formation. Offset power I formation. Breaking the wishbone. A handoff to the I back. That is Miles Semler, and he is wrapped up for a loss.
Well, you got Canton with a lot of those defensive players up in the box. You got those corners and the safeties playing way up. Not a lot of room, plus you shoot the gap. Ethan Murtha coming in there.
Gabe Dolan.
Austin Shures is the one that came in there, shot the gap.
So second down now, 12 yards to go.
Look how tight defensively Canton bringing all those players up within 5 yards of the line of scrimmage. Nine in the box.
This time it will be Dvorak keeping it himself, but he's run down defensively by Anders Peterson. That was a good reaction by Peterson, because I thought that was going for a while. Take a look. Dvorak takes it on the naked bootleg.
Probably should have just kept running there instead of stopping. Keep your momentum, try to get to the outside.
There was good pursuit, but never, and there was a pickup of seven, but still, that looked like it was going for more. Third down now, 5 yards to go. Back in at quarterback is Zach Scott. Dvorak is one of the wideouts. Scott drops back under pressure, gets away. Now he's going to be drugged down at the 35-yard line. He'll pick up half a yard, but it will be fourth down and 4 yards to go.
Josh Lasley in the pursuit. You see number 72 fighting off a block, fighting off one of those linemen, and in the right place at the right time, and made it happen.
Stayed right where he needed to stay, and now Parkston is going to use the time. Oh, no, that's the end of the quarter. Sorry. That's the end of the quarter. The Seahawks on top of the Trojans, 14-7. We're back to the Dakota Dome after this timeout on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Welcome back to the Dakota Dome in Vermilion. Fourth down for the Parkston Trojans. Dvorak on to do the punting.
Averages 35 yards.
He'll take his time and now launch it. And it went white off the left side of his foot.
That might be a 20-yard punt.
I don't think it's going to be that far, Craig. That really took a nasty angle.
15.
Yep, 15-yard punt. Canton will take over first and 10 at their own 49-yard line. They went on a march of 80 yards in 13 plays and ate up 6 minutes and 44 seconds the last time they had the ball. They lead it now 14-7. Cody Majors, the 6-foot senior, hands it to Broughton, the fullback. Broughton is ridden down.
Does that surprise you? This whole game, these defensive lines stacking up at the line of scrimmage, fighting off blocks.
Mitch Heisinger came up from his linebacker position. He was in a linebacker there to make the tackle. Yeah, this has just been, you know, that shot that we had. And again, congratulations to the boys from and gals from South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I can't leave that out. Outstanding job on some of our camera work. And I'll get back to my point here after this next snap. Majors hands it off to Dolan. Dolan stacked up at the line of scrimmage. Well, picks up about 3 or 4 yards on the carry. But that picture that we had a few moments ago when Parkston had the ball and you brought up the fact that Canton had 9 men in the box, that has been the microcosm of what our Class 11B championship game has been about the last 5 years or so. Just great teams that control the ball, that play defense, that want to control the line of scrimmage, and it has made for some very compelling high school football.
Canton, 135 yards rushing, 102 yards passing. This will be the 40th play of the game for Canton.
So third down here, a chance for Parkston to come up with the turnover, with the getting the ball back, and they will. A big defensive play there by the Parkston Trojan defense. They will stop Canton on third down. And now Canton will be forced to give up the football.
Well, Canton tried to send 3 guys right through the same hole with Majors being the last one, but Parkston's D holds. Going to have to punt.
Dvorak drops back along with Blake Beats. Beats just a freshman.
Tyler Lems will punt. Noticed it here in the dome. Because of the dome, some of these guys doing more line drive punts, hoping to get pretty good bounce down the other end of the field.
You can get it tumbling your direction, but that's the bad part with a football. It's very, very unpredictable. And a timeout going to be called by Rich Lundstrom, and that's going to leave the Seahawks with just 1 left. Rich saw something he didn't like there. Either that or the fake was on, and he decided to change that play. Hey, every antique is a survivor, but considering some have made it through exceptionally dangerous circumstances, it's amazing they survived it all. Monday, in a special episode, Antiques Roadshow highlights amazing tales of rescues, near misses, and beating the odds. That's Monday night on SDPB1. And Craig, how cool was it to watch the Antiques Roadshow that was filmed out in Rapid City? That was just so cool. To see those stories, some of those things had been in families hundreds of years and had traveled across the prairie. That was just great fun. And I know that the folks at South Dakota Public Broadcasting really enjoyed bringing the Antiques Roadshow crew to Rapid as well.
Adam Eshe coming in late here for Canton. He's going to be on that line here as they are going to punt it away. At least we think they're going to punt it away.
Well, I would think if you're going to fake it, you're probably not going to call a timeout right before you fake it.
Well, Tyler Lambs, remember, is the center. I don't know if he's thrown any passes this year.
I would doubt it.
Parkston, though, will send, though, Dvorak and Beats back deep. Check that. They're going to send back David Voorhees.
And now Parkston's going to line up and go, or they're going to, Canton goes for it. First down.
And
are you kidding me? Donlin around the corner. Okay, I admit, everything I said in the last minute, go back through your DVR, do me a favor, and erase it, because I was completely wrong. Wow, at the last minute, they line it up to run it. And Gabe Dolan rumbles down the sidelines, down to the 16-yard line. My goodness. Apparently, the folks from Parkston were thinking the same thing I was. Well, you're not going to fake it if you're going to call a timeout right before then. Dolan will get inside the 10. It will be first down and goal for the Canton Seahawks.
Well, we knew something was going to happen, but they held the cards pretty tight to their body.
I'd say so. It wasn't enough for the first down. Excuse me. He did come up just shy. So second down and about a long yard, a very long yard. Here's the offset power eye. Handoff. Dolan left side. Now he'll have the first down. Inside the 5, it'll be first and goal. And the clock continues to roll. Now the Trojans do have all 3 of their timeouts left. But points have been tough to come by. Aside from the trickeration from earlier today from Josh Rands to Brady Reef. Canton, they have controlled the line of scrimmage in this second half, and they have owned the time of possession. Handoff, Dolan, down to the 1. Met there by a couple of Semlers. Brady Reef in on the tackle, which is no surprise. Austin Bertram. Clock now rolls under 8 minutes to play. Second down and goal. Ball just outside the 1-yard line. Cody Majors. Let's see if they go to Tanner Broughton, the fullback. He'll be on the right side. Gabe Dolan is the eye back. Schurz in the slot goes in motion. Majors keeps it himself. They're going to mark him short. They're going to mark him short. Yep. The Canton fans thought he was in, but that knee went down just shy. Take a look at where this ball is spotted.
I wonder some of these linesmen, how can you tell sometimes?
Oh, there you go. Oh. Excellent call. Excellent job by the head linesman and this crew.
Well, now the Parkston fans right in front of the play here on their feet, making some noise.
Third down, goal to go. Majors, this time he'll take it.
Oh, wow, he didn't make it either.
He didn't make it this time either.
Did not make it. Wow. Jeff Hike, the nose guard or the nose tackle, he got a nice push. Didn't get it.
No, he was farther away that time than he was the last time. Jeff Hike, 6 foot, 300 pounds, and a junior. Fourth down and goal. Ball a half a yard from pay dirt.
You would think you still do the quarterback keep right here. You still try to do the quarterback keep.
Clock
shortest distance.
Clock rolling near the 6-minute mark. Broughton, right side, got there.
Uh-oh, flag. I think that's going to go against Canton.
It's going to be an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty, but it will be after the touchdown. Personal foul.
On Parkston.
On Parkston. I believe, if memory serves me, this will be enforced on the kick.
Unsportsmanlike conduct on the defense. Half the difference to go.
So on the extra point, it looks like Canton is now going to go for 2 since they got the free yardage. 20-7 is the score with 6:08 to play in the ballgame. Canton has owned the line of scrimmage and, as we said before, dominated time of possession in the second half. They have scored 20 consecutive points. They're looking for 22. Majors, Schurz in motion. Handoff, Broughton, met at the end zone and did not get in. Extra point is no good. 6:08 to play in the fourth. Seahawks on top of the Trojans, 20-7. We're back after this timeout on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. The Parkston Trojans jumped out to the 7-0 lead on the pass in the first quarter from Rands to Reef. But since that time, Canton has put 20 consecutive points on the board. And they now lead it 20-7 with 6:08 left to play here in the ballgame. Appreciate getting the notes from, like we said, across the state of South Dakota. Tonight, Pierre and Watertown will be in the dome for the 11AA championship. The kick is away. That one sails well over the head. Oh, baby, was that hammered. Nice job on the kick by Ratcliffe. And so it will be first and 10 for the Parkston Trojans. Wes Dvorak, the junior quarterback, will bring him out. Again, this Trojan team is a team that has seen a lot of these guys play at very young ages. They've got seniors and juniors scattered throughout the lineup, but a lot of these kids played when they were freshmen and sophomores. They have taken their lumps, but they have gotten better. Zach Scott now in at quarterback. As Dvorak goes to a wideout. Scott to Dvorak, caught, and then tipped away.
Did he catch it before he went out of bounds? Stayed in bounds and then lost it? Let's see what they say. Incomplete. That was quite
They're
going to
discuss it. They're discussing it down on the sideline.
That was quite the athletic move.
Incomplete pass. It is an incomplete pass. Take a look here as the pump. And then Majors with the coverage. The ball goes up. It's caught by Dvorak, and then Majors is able to strip it away. Good call there by the officials and good camera work on that sideline. With 6:02 left to play, the clock is stopped. The Trojans have all three of their timeouts left, but they now trail by two scores. Staying in at quarterback is Zach Scott. He was the starting quarterback last year. The handoff goes to Miles Semler on the left side. He'll spin forward and keep muscling his way rugby scrum style all the way out to the 25. That will bring up third down. But again, the clock continues to roll. Going with the no huddle are the Parkston Trojans. Out of the shotgun, Zach Scott gets the snap, drops back. Looks to throw, has a man, that's Reef over his head. Brady Reef, who made the huge catch against St. Thomas More to basically save the season for the Trojans. Can't come up with that one. Just a little over his head and had him a little out of position. And that will bring up fourth down now with the clock stopped at 5.5 minutes to play.
Teams that rush and rush and have a lot of yardage on the ground during the year, sometimes when it comes time to actually having to throw the ball, sometimes they're not used to it. We saw that earlier in the Avon Hamlin game today.
So fourth down, 5 yards to go. Scott throws. Dvorak. Dvorak tries to cut back, can't get anywhere, and the defense of the Canton Seahawks come up big, and Canton will take over first and 10 at the 25-yard line of Parkston.
I like the call. I mean, you have to. With 5:20 to go in the game, you need two scores. I think you had to do it. This game, of course, is a rematch of a game that was back in September. In fact, five of our championship games were rematches of games from earlier in the year. And so far, the teams that lost in the regular season have won championships this weekend.
Tanner Broughton is the lone setback. He gets the handoff. Falls forward for a yard.
Potter County did that in 9A. West Central did it last night, where they were beaten by the team that they beat yesterday. And now Canton lost to Parkston. They got a chance to take the title and avenging that loss.
The clock will continue to roll. Now it goes under 5 minutes to play. Parkston with all three of their timeouts. They won't spend them yet. Cody Majors once again has Broughton as the lone setback. And a false start on Canton. That time they were going with the pitch to one of the wingbacks. I think that was going to go to Niffen. And it was Broughton, actually, that got an early start because he knew he was going to be the blocker on that.
Fourth penalty.
False start on the offense. Five-yard penalty. Second down.
And once again, a good look at Andy Dinert, a kid that won a state title playing for Stickney Mount Vernon. The quarterback was Chad Greenway, but just one of those great stories of a kid who wanted to stay involved in high school athletics, and he did it by putting on the whistle. Power eye formation. Dolan gets back to the line of scrimmage, not much more, but more importantly, the clock is back running, now moving at the 4:20 mark. If you are looking to stay involved or to get involved with high school or junior high athletics, call your local athletic director. I guarantee you, if you're looking to help officiate anything, they've got a spot for you.
Yep.
And there's a lot of people across the state of South Dakota that will help train you as well. Just another way to stay involved with high school activities that have such a positive effect on so many kids.
Canton's going to get delayed game here if they don't hurry up.
Clock now at 3:45. They'll hustle back
five,
to the line of scrimmage.
4, 3, 2.
Majors just got it off, but he lost the ball. He was able to fall on top of it. But he can live with that because, again, the clock continues to roll.
Fourth down. You wonder, are you going to go for the field goal here? Be a long one, certainly be a real long one.
And a timeout now going to be called by Parkston. Parkston will spend their first timeout.
Well, for Canton, first time they've been in the Dome since 06 when they defeated Del Rapids in double overtime. Third trip to the Dome for Canton. Meanwhile, for Parkston, this is their first trip to the Dome in 11 years. They lost to Clark back in 02, 27-18. In fact, in this game, in both the games at Aberdeen-Roncalli and at Winter for Canton, it was tied at halftime and they came back to win in the second half.
By the way, that was back when Clark, Northeast Conference, what used to be the Northeast Conference, was on a pretty good roll there for a while, weren't they? That was an incredible conference. But, you know, those are some of the things that we talked about. If you missed it, you know, Hamlin playing 9B football because they had petitioned down because so many of the kids that are in their hallways aren't out for sports because of religious reasons. Well, you know, the state of South Dakota is dealing with this on a regular basis when it comes to the shift in bodies. There just aren't bodies at some of these schools anymore. Webster used to be so solid in 11-man football, and that Northeast Conference was just as good as it got, but majority of those have now had to drop down to 9-man. Fourth down, Majors drops back. He's under pressure. He threw it away. Are you kidding me? An interception out to the 40-yard line. And suddenly, with 3:13 left to play, Austin Bertram has given Parkston a big-time spark.
They were trying to go the wide receiver screen to Bryce Schrodermeyer, and he threw it right to Austin Bertram.
There you see,
didn't
there's pressure.
See him at all.
Nope, never saw him. And so let's see what the Parkston Trojans can do with it. Zach Scott is back in at quarterback. He is the thrower of the two. He'll throw that one over the middle. It was tipped. Niffen got a piece of it. It was behind the intended receiver. It will fall incomplete, but the incomplete pass stops the clock at 3:08. Canton on top, 20-7. Canton with one timeout left. I'm willing to bet that doesn't get spent. Trojans with two timeouts left. They want to stretch this thing out as long as they possibly can. Scott in the shotgun. Drops back under pressure. Screen pass. Heisinger right side and gets away from Niffen, then out of bounds at the 48-yard line. A pickup of about 8 on the play. It will bring up third down and 2. But again, as the clock now stops at 3:01, after Heisinger got out of bounds, you know that this is 4-down territory no matter what happens. Or not 4-down territory, but 4-down time no matter what happens on this play.
Kyler Niffen on that last tackle, open field tackle.
Now Scott will check out of the lineup. And there's no quarterback. Oh, yeah, there we go, Dvorak. There's Dvorak. Now they will go in the wishbone formation. Semler was the fullback. They'll get it off to Heisinger, and he'll power forward for a first down down to the 45-yard line. That will stop the clock as they reset the chains.
Canton will let them run like that the rest of the game. Parkston needs to get downfield.
So Scott is back in at quarterback. He'll drop back. Canton back in big defense. A throw to Reeve. Caught! 10! Out of bounds! 6-yard line!
What a great throw. Threw it up. Reef had his man beat. What a great throw.
They had him double covered, but the big man rumbled his way behind the defense. Reef, who came up with the catch that basically saved the season for Parkston against St. Thomas More, comes up with another big one here. Dvorak back in at quarterback. They'll hand it off. Right side, Heisinger gets nowhere. Met at the line of scrimmage, and the clock continues to roll. Defensively, among the folks that were in on the tackle there, Ripley and others.
A lot of time going off the clock here.
Dvorak has Semler at the fullback. Handed off on the counter to Heisinger on the right side. He'll get down to the 2-yard line. But again, still not into the end zone, and the clock will now move under 2 minutes to play. Trojans needing two scores. So third down, goal to go. Dvorak will turn around, reset the play. Another 10 seconds or so goes off the clock, and getting nowhere is Andrew Semler, and now Parkston has to call a timeout.
Great pursuit of that defensive front, Van Vorst and Lems, just busting up the play.
Take a look at it. The handoff goes to Andrew Semler, and he is met and knocked down. So it will be fourth down and goal when the Parkston Trojans come back out over the ball. That is the second timeout by the Trojans. They will have one left. Once again, we want to thank the City of Vermilion for being such great hosts and hostesses for the South Dakota High School football finals. Yes, I know they're the only town in the state that has a dome, but they never take that for granted. They do a great job. You're not going to see a bunch of price gouging going on. You're going to see people who are genuinely welcome you to town. We always appreciate that. So here we go. Fourth down, goal to go. Dvorak at quarterback. in the offset power eye formation. Handoff goes to the first man through. He got there.
Boy, I don't think it was by much, Mike. That was close. Just getting in.
I want to see. Was it Bertram? Is that who was carrying the ball?
Yes, it was.
I'll be doggone. No wonder I didn't have that call. Sorry.
The tackle.
Austin Bertram was lined up at the fullback position, and he is able to power his way into the end zone. The kick, very important. Up and good.
Now we're going to get ready for an onside kick now,
yes,
Mike.
We are. It's onside kick time. Reminder coming up for you tonight. We have got the Pier Governors coming to town to take on the Watertown Arrows.
8 plays, 59 yards, minute and a half, and it all was because of that interception by Austin Bertram. In fact, how about that? You make the interception, and then you score the touchdown later.
So a minute 35 left to go. Rich Lundstrom is going to put in his hands team. And for those of you who don't watch football on a regular basis, rather than having a bunch of offensive linemen type up front who normally do the blocking, he will put in guys who are receivers and running backs and folks that are better with their hands, because you know that Parkston is going to try to onside kick this. Seahawks on top, 20-14.
Total yards, Canton 288, Parkston 242.
I imagine, have you got time of possession up there, Craig? Because Canton has owned the second half when it came to time of possession.
I do not have
it
that.
It balanced out a little bit here on this last drive by Parkston. But you will see that Majors will be the lone back. He will line up at about his own 23-yard line. Other than that, Canton, they've got a bunch of guys with numbers in the 20s and 30s and 10s out there ready to handle this football. The kick will be from the 40. It goes opposite side. It's recovered momentarily by Parkston, but then Canton got on it.
That wouldn't have counted anyway, Mike, because it was touched 10 yards. It was touched before that 10-yard cushion. You got to let the ball go 10 yards before you can touch it. And Parkston touched it before it hit the 50.
And that's where the penalty flag came in.
Illegal touching on the kicking team.
And so it will belong to the Canton Seahawks.
Parkston will be able to stop the clock once. Basically, all Canton has to do is get a good exchange from the center, from Lems to Majors.
Checking into the lineup comes Niffen, who had a touchdown earlier. A minute 34 left to play. They won't take the victory formation just yet. The handoff to Broughton. Broughton works his way down to the 44-yard line.
And now Parkston has to call their last timeout.
They will call that timeout with a minute 26 left to play.
If this holds, Mike, Canton would be one of just two teams to win an 11A championship and an 11B championship. The other one?
Harrisburg?
Winner,
okay.
Winner, two titles in 11B. They've got three titles in 11A. The Canton, two titles in 11A, and this would be their first in 11B.
See, there's a prime example back to what we were talking about earlier. I guess Harrisburg. Harrisburg, actually, they have now been in three different classes over the course of 12 years. you know, as they have continued to grow. T area, it wasn't that long ago, the T area was 9B when they first started their program. And now they're 11A. So second down.
See if Majors just takes a knee. Should be able to just take a knee here.
I don't think so. They're going to hand it off, Broughton.
Wow.
I think they want one more first down. So now the clock will continue to roll. The Canton Seahawks. Their only loss on the year was to Parkston in the second week of the season.
Okay, they start the play clock now with 1:03.
So still a couple more plays. As it's third down, Canton, again, just the one loss. They defeated West Central this year for the first time since 1989 when Burdell Copland was coaching.
He's not going to get the first down.
He is not, and so that's going to bring up a fourth down. Clock continuing to roll. Let's see where they get this ball set and marked. Will they start it? The clock. That's it.
They don't
That's
have to run
do
a play.
It. They do not have to run a play. The Canton Seahawks, who went on the road, defeated Aberdeen Roncalli, a previously undefeated Roncalli team in Aberdeen. They then went on the road and they defeated the undefeated Winter Warriors. A lot of people told them that they were giant killers. Well, it turns out they're the Giants themselves, and they pick up the 20-14 victory for the Class 11B title. Craig, if you want to see 11B football for the last 7 years in South Dakota, play a tape of this.
Absolutely.
Huh?
Great defense on both clubs. Saw some trickery a little bit.
A terrific season by the Parkston Trojans. Nice to see them back. Competitive when it comes to football. They struggled there, as we said, for a few years while some of these young kids took their lumps. A lot of good talent coming back. Of course, Parkston so successful in so many programs through the course of the last 10 years, whether it be wrestling or girls or boys basketball, track, you name it. They went 4-5 last year, and now they were all the way to the Dome. Our thanks again to Dan Gensler and the folks at SDSportsHistory.com for providing us with information during all of these games. You can find out information at SDSportsHistory.com, and of course SDSportsHistory.com brought to you by the good folks at Shoneman's. We like Shoneman's a lot. Locally owned company for well over 100 years. And so the Canton Seahawks pick up the victory over the Trojans of Parkston. Both teams continue to shake hands coming up tonight at 7 o'clock Central, 6 Mountain. The Pier Governors take on the Watertown Arrows for you right here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. And it's time now to hand out some hardware, so let's send it down to Joe Van Gore.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I direct your attention to the center of the playing field to present the awards to the 2013 runner-up and championship teams for Class 11B football are Dan Whalen and Darren Paulson from the Board of Directors of the South Dakota High School Activities Association, and assisting with a team awards presentation are representatives from the Activities Association's corporate partners, Scott Larson from Sanford Health, Nathan Hofer from Farmers Union Insurance, Sergeant First Class Eric Mason from the South Dakota Army National Guard, along with representatives from First Premier Bank and Premier Bankcard, and from Billion Automotive. First of all, the runner-up trophy, finishing with a record of 10-2, head coach Eric Norton and the Parkston Trojans. And now, for the Class 11B Championship Trophy, head coach Rich Lundstrom and the Canton Seahawks finishing with a record of 11-1. Fans, if we can have your attention, please. Members of the media covering the football championships select a Joe Robbie Most Valuable Player Award for the outstanding performance by a member of the championship team. This member of the Canton Seahawks had 11 rushes for 11 yards, 5 of 6 passing for 102 yards, and 7 tackles on defense. Please congratulate Cody Majors of Canton, the Joe Robbie Most Valuable Player. Awarding is Paul Priester from the Vermilion Area Chamber of Commerce and Development Company. And also, the South Dakota High School Coaches Association selects an outstanding lineman and an outstanding back of this 11B championship game. The outstanding lineman from Canton High School, number 77, Aaron Van Borst. And the outstanding back of this 11B championship game from Canton, number 20, Gabe Dolan.
And so, congratulations to the Canton Seahawks, and an outstanding job also by the folks from Parkston. Standing by on the sideline is Steve Toome. Steve?
All right, guys, thank you a lot, Coach. Congratulations on the win. I want to take you back to a couple of fourth down plays, about 9.5 minutes left to go. You decided to go for it on fourth down. You called a timeout. Take us through that situation.
Well, we were running out of time there. The ref was counting it off, so I talked to the guys when I got out to the huddle and said, hey, what do you think? Should we go diesel on this? And they were, heck yeah, they were all for that. I thought we might have a little bit of an advantage if we went with a quick count, and we did, and it paid off. That was a huge play.
Then you got down to the goal line, fourth and goal, 1 yard line. Tell us through your decision making through that play.
Just had to give it to the big horse again. Tanner has been running through walls for us, so we had to go. You know, if we don't make it there, they got 99 yards to go. So it was a no-brainer to give it to him.
Coach, defensively, your team was stellar in the second half, again, shutting out Parkston. Talk about your defense and their effort today.
I can't say enough about the defense. All year, they've been bringing it. Today we had a few slip-ups, some miscommunication and some guys that were out of position, but for the most part, you know, holding Parkston to 242 yards is a great effort, and they've been doing it all year, and I'm extremely proud of all of them.
Coach, congratulations on the win. I'll let you go celebrate with your team.
All right, thank you.
Rich Lundstrom, the head man for the Canton Seahawks. Believe it or not, guys, the lower seed, they've won every game so far. Must be something with the white jerseys this weekend here at the Dakota Dome. Let's take a timeout, come back with more. This is the 11B Championship Football Game on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
with Steve Toome and Craig Maddock. I'm Mike Henriksen. Canton picks up the victory over Parkston. Let's take a look at some of those final stats as you see the Canton team gathering there to celebrate as the Seahawks trailed it 7-0. There you see things pretty even, but Canton did such a great job in that second half of owning the time of possession and piling up the yards. Canton comes from behind to pick up the victory over Parkston. Taking a look at some of those highlights, Parkston took better care of the ball in the second half, but of course they didn't have the ball all that much in the second half. There's the touchdown as Assurance is able to get into the end zone.
That was a 13-play, 80-yard drive. Took almost 7 minutes. And then Dolan with the big run to set up.
That was on fourth down. They converted the fourth down. The other way.
Parkston scores. Austin Bertram, after he had picked off a pass, 8 plays, 59 yards. Took about a minute and a half. And then the onside kick didn't work out the best. It was touched before it went 10 yards, and Canton able to run out the clock and win their third title.
And so we'll be back to the Dakota Dome right after this timeout. You're watching high school football coverage exclusively on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Free statewide broadcast of this South Dakota High School Sports Championship is underwritten by the thousands of members of the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, by Mid-Continent Communications, and by Dakota Bank.
And so from the Dakota Dome, the Canton Seahawks pick up the 11-B victory over the Trojans of Parkston by a final of 20-14. Potter County got their first title yesterday. Bridgewater Emory Ethan picked one up yesterday afternoon as well. And then West Central with their 12th overall title last night in a dandy against the Madison Bulldogs. This afternoon, it was Avon getting another title, coming from behind to defeat previously undefeated Hamlin. And then here, the Seahawks down the Trojans. Coming up tonight, we've got Pierre and Watertown, and tomorrow night, it's Sioux Falls-Lincoln versus Sioux Falls-Roosevelt. Lots of great coverage coming your way online at sdpb.org and right here on your television. We'll come back to the Dome one final time to wrap things up after this timeout on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.